So it doesn't matter whether in this culture you have any type of special skill or ability. All that matters is that you step in front of a camera. And so Warhol was the first to do this. He would point his camera at people doing boring activities like sleeping in a bed. He would film it and then release it on a theater screen, and you would be subjected to 2 hours of a man sleeping on a bed. Or he would do the same thing with somebody eating or drinking. He was the first to point a camera at the Empire State Building and then subject audiences later on to his 8-hour epic of changing lights and shadows on the Empire State Building. But he's really onto something here. He's beginning to be sensitive to what the nature of electronic media are and what they do when they film something. The medium determines the content of what pours through it. McLuhan had this absolutely correct. Other people who have misunderstood him have come along since then and said, to say, well, that he really got it wrong. It's not the medium, it's what goes through the medium. But see, the problem with that is that it is exactly what goes through the medium is actually what the medium is allowed to take on and channel through it. It is the medium that structures the message that goes through it. And Warhol was sensitive to that here. The other thing I think you can look, he also had an idea for a show that he was going to call Nothing Special. And he was going to put, he never did it, but he had planned to put a movie camera on a corner and just leave it running. And that was going to be a television show. And so there again, he's prescient of the developments of Google coming along. We see on the streets the Google mobiles. I've seen them with the cameras strapped atop them that go along photographing the sites. He would have perfectly understood, would have been one of the few who would have perfectly understood the popularity of YouTube's Lonely Girl 15, which was a show in which a 19-year-old girl played a 16-year-old girl with her webcam on, sitting around in her apartment doing absolutely nothing special. And the enormous popularity of that is very difficult to explain, but Warhol would have understood it perfectly. You simply turn on the camera and the individual is plugged in, an avatar is created, and it's the avatar that's the thing. The avatar is the thing here. so that's what Warhol was sensitive to here. And then after the death and disaster paintings, in which he begins to become sensitive to the coming of this oxymoron of the anonymous celebrity, the famous nobody, and that's where we get the famous statement that he makes, in the future everyone will be famous for 15 minutes, another prophetic statement that he made. In 1964, he was asked by Robert Moses to make a contribution to the New York World's Fair at that time. And there was a building that had been designed by the postmodern architect Philip Johnson, and Warhol was asked to contribute something for that building. And what he did was rather brilliant. He took the FBI's most wanted list, and he collected all the photographs, and he made a collage of photographs out of the FBI's most wanted, blew it up to macro scale, and had it put on the outside of the building exactly like the way in the Middle Ages you would put the images of saints on the exteriors of the buildings, or in the stained glass on the inside. And the avant-garde status of this was confirmed promptly by worrying Robert Moses, who was afraid that because most of them were Italians that it might be some kind of a racial slur, so he told Warhol to take it down. But Warhol threatened to put in its place a mass-reproduced image of Robert Moses, and so Moses just settled for having him spray-paint the thing silver and efface it in that way. Now, another great brilliant work of art here. The most wanted man is an image that's looking into the future, and the artist is the distant early warning system of a society. This is another of McLuhan's truisms that is absolutely correct. The artist is always the one whose radar is sensitive to what's coming ahead. Anything that happens in a society, you can always go back and find it in the decades of the works of art that are being produced. You can see it coming. And I think here that what Warhol saw with the most wanted men is the coming of the popularity of television shows like Cops and America's Most Wanted, and films like Oliver Stone's Natural Born Killers, in which you have criminals becoming famous. In this society, it doesn't matter. The moral quality of the individual is absolutely negligible. It matters nothing in electronic society, in which the individual can become a celebrity, as Manson did, for murdering other individuals. Serial killers can become famous too. It is exactly James Joyce's Here Comes Everybody that he wrote about in Finnegan's Wake that's going on here. Electronic technology changes the society. In this case, it simply eliminates, it shears morality right off the surface of the deeds that anyone does in such a society. And so the most wanted men was prophetic of the coming of these kinds of reality TV television shows. He saw those coming. Then after 1964, he begins to He paints some more of these death and disaster paintings. He paints a series of atomic explosions going off and an electric chair. He's really fascinated in these paintings with death. And a lot of the people who accuse him of being trivial and overly optimistic tend to forget and neglect these paintings where he had this fascination with death. And the fascination with death was really part of the motivation for everything that he was doing here. It really is a cult of the dead that he's constructing in these years before he was shot in 1968. These are his best years, from 62 to 68. He was really one of the great artists in the world, I think, at this time. And it's easy to overlook him and to deride him and dismiss him because of the effect that his art had. Others who come along after him and imitate him and just say, well, I can do the same thing, just throwing images on the computer screen and printing them out and selling them, are missing the point. These guys are imitators. They didn't see this first. Warhol saw this first, and he's opening up a whole new dimension of art here. It's brand new, and at the time it was completely avant-garde. The art world had shifted, starting with Jackson Pollock, of course, to New York in the 50s, and now in the 60s and 70s. It was the place to be. But now we begin to see some foreshadowings of the coming of Warhol's demise, as it were. One day in 1964, he said that a woman walked into his loft, walked in with a revolver, pointed at a stack of his Marilyns, and fired a bullet hole through it and walked out. We don't know who the woman is, but it's not a good omen. And when things like that start happening, you've got to start questioning who it is that's around you. But it didn't seem to worry him much, and things were normal for about another 4 years until a woman named Valerie Solanas crossed paths with him. Now, Valerie Solanas was kind of a nutcase, basically. She had written something called Scum, she had founded a society called Scum, the Society for the Cutting Up of Men. She was a man-hater, and Maurice Girodias had published her, in the Grove Books Press series, had published her manifesto. And she became obsessed with Warhol, and she became not only obsessed, but she convinced that he was doing damage to her somehow. And so she walked in up to his loft one day, June 3rd, 1968, and pulled out a .38 caliber revolver and shot him two or three times, then calmly took the freight elevator down and left the building. And when she was caught, she said simply, "I had to do it because Warhol tied me up lock, stock, and barrel. There was no way I couldn't shoot him." And so we have another example. This is our third example of the celebrity stalker. This almost killed Warhol, by the way. He was pronounced clinically dead that day at 4:51 p.m. in the afternoon. He was pronounced clinically dead, so he just barely survived. This is our third example we had in the case of JFK, Lee Harvey Oswald. If we put on the pretense that he acted alone, we would have the celebrity stalker there. And we had a kind of modified celebrity stalker with Ralph Greenson and his possession of Marilyn Monroe. And here we have the first actual clear-cut case of a celebrity stalker going in and trying to take control of her own life back away from the man whose avatar had captured her. It's almost as though she were a weak ego who had come into the orbit of this gravitational mass of this personality that just drew her in, and she couldn't find any other way of escaping than by trying to kill him and take her own life back. So she was more or less a prisoner inside the mind of Andy Warhol. She was living in his mind the same way that Warhol, when he had first started out, was really living in the minds of these celebrities that he was adulating, that he was worshiping. And the only way really that he enabled himself to get free of those celebrities was by creating with the factory his own cult of the celebrity, where he would take the famous, or where he would take the nobodies who surrounded him and simply give them cameras and make these silly films and turn them into what he called superstars. And he himself became his own myth maker, his own star maker at that point. And then he came out of the influence of these dead celebrities and took control over his own life. Valerie Solanas had to do this by murdering the real Andy Warhol. What she was actually trying to do was to kill his avatar, the image of him, the clone of him. But she mistook that in an act of misplaced concreteness and tried to eliminate the real Andy Warhol. She had been taken captive by his avatar. Warhol actually himself at this time, he was making appearances on talk shows and television, and he was becoming something of a cult figure. And he did generate his own doppelgangers of himself. He was fascinated with the idea of the double, the doppelganger. In 1967, he had hired a man named Alan Majette to put on a silver wig and face makeup and go on a tour for him to appear in his stead, saying that he was Andy Warhol, going to university campuses and answering questions. And it was easier for him to do because Warhol was so laconic when he gave responses. His normal stock answer was either, uh-huh, yep, or nope, Those were, to the frustration of people who interviewed him, those were his normal answers. And so it was a very easy stunt to pull off. But some college kids figured it out by comparing photographs, and the university, when they found out about it, were absolutely furious with him. And so they forced him, they put pressure on him to go and do this live to make up for the stunt that he had pulled. But we see him here already creating a duplicate of himself, already replacing himself with a simulacrum. And later on in his career, he toyed with the idea of creating an Andy Warhol robot that he could then put to go out and do tours for him, to speak on his behalf. So he was fascinated with that process. Now, with Valerie Solana shooting him, he survived, but his life after 1968 was never the same. It's almost as though he were resurrected like Lazarus from the cave. When Jesus resurrects Lazarus, and Lazarus comes out of the cave, it's not the same Lazarus anymore. It's a kind of pale, faded version of him. Lazarus has left something essential behind in the resurrection process. And I think the same thing can be said of Andy Warhol. In a certain sense, we can say that the myth demands that he should not have survived the assassination. He is performing the myth of the celebrity stalker. He had been fascinated, we saw in his early death and disaster paintings, with the car crash, which is one of the primary archetypal celebrity death modes, the car crash, the death by overdose. He hated drugs, so he wasn't interested in drugs, and the death by stalker. So we have both the stalker and the car crash playing through his work as main celebrity themes. So he narrowly averted death by this point, but his later stuff is not as good. The other art is nowhere near as good as the early art. And his life changed. He had always been pale, but he looked paler than before, and he was terrified of women from this point for the rest of his life. And instead of hanging out, you know, the days of hanging out at the factory with bohemian crazies was pretty much over with. In his later years, he traded that off for hanging out with rich people, and his art suffered for it because a great degree of his creativity, as we mentioned earlier, depended upon the input that these crazies gave him in his art. And so the later art suffers. It's a pale art by comparison with the early stuff. And so in a certain sense, he should not have survived. Even his autobiography, Popism, ends in 1969 with the assassination attempt by Solanas forming the book's climax, as though there were nothing else of significance that ever happened to him after that point. So in a certain sense, it's a confession that at the end of his life, Warhol had achieved basically what he had tried to do all along, was to replace himself with a simulacrum. And that's the chapter on Andy Warhol.